Hello, and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be learning about stoichiometry. Now, with this concept, this is something that all chemistry students eventually will have to learn, which is essentially taking all of the different skills that you've been learning throughout the semester and tying them together and relating them through the chemical formula or through relationships that you've learned about in dimensional analysis or through equations and swap drops and all these different methods. Now, whenever you see this pronunciation here, stoichiometry, right? So saying that out loud to yourself, because most likely there's going to be you and about five other classmates that will struggle with pronouncing this, but it's not that scary. It's not too difficult if you know your fundamentals and your basics, which is the goal of this video. It's just to tell you what's the whole idea of it. And if you want to learn more about the mathematics behind it, refer to my other videos on introduction to stoichiometry, limiting reagents, gas stoichiometry, and solution stoichiometry, and probably many more that are going to come as time passes. So the whole idea with this is when we're looking at stoichiometry is, can you read a recipe? And essentially, like, if you cook at home or make anything, or even, heck, if you just read the back of a box to microwave something, you have essentially used some kind of recipe. Even if you've just ordered food, right, to actually prepare all those things, how are they putting all together? If you ever made something, you're following instructions, and it takes so many ingredients to put that together. That's where we're going to be relating to this, is something as simple as cooking. Let's take a look. Let's say I want to make a simple cheeseburger. Well, if you were to make a burger at home or to cook anything, you probably follow a recipe, you probably Google it, look it up in the Food Network or some kind of recipe, and you see exactly how to make and see if you have those ingredients at home. Or maybe you just listen from the heart and just mix things together, but you're still following some kind of recipe, meaning that there's a specific ratio between all those ingredients to make the thing you want, right? If you don't follow them, you're going to start trying to make like something like bread, and you're going to end up with a cake. They're going to be completely different things. So if I want to make a burger, well, how would I do it? Well, my secret recipe is up here, so don't tell anybody else. As simple as just taking a hamburger patty with a slice of cheese and two buns, and you got a burger. Now, if we were to write this out, let's say if we want to show it more like a chemical equation, well, we could do that, right? So right here, I have my two buns, and they're mixing with my piece of cheese and mixing with my patty, and they exist within a specific ratio, right? We see two buns with one slice of cheese and then one patty, mixing those together to make one burger. Now, if I were to ask you something really simple about this recipe, how many burgers can I make with 13 buns? So you look in your pantry, you see that you only have 13 buns. And let me say you have as much hamburger meat and cheese in the fridge as you possibly want. You have them in excess, meaning there's a ton of them available. How many burgers can you make? And well, you're probably like thinking like, well, I can make six and a half, right? So 13 divided by two for the buns, six and a half. And you were able to think of that without really doing any type of fancy math or anything you've learned in chemistry. So you'd be like, well, what's the whole point of stoichiometry? Well, that's the whole idea, is you're looking at relationships. So from those 13 buns, we can simply just say that we can make six and a half burgers from that. Now, how could we show that in terms of actual stoichiometry? Let's take a look at what this is. So when you're looking at this recipe, essentially all this is showing it. Can you show it with dimensional analysis? Stoichiometry is just dimensional analysis. It's unit conversions. Since the very beginning of my channel and all these videos that I give to all my students, I've been telling everybody since day one, it's just unit conversions. That's all chemistry truly is. Can you cancel your units? So if we want to do the same problem, right, where we said we were starting with 13 buns. So let's say if I take my buns from all the way up here and I'm to copy them down, can we actually show this like a math problem? Can you cancel it? How did you get to six and a half by doing that in your head? Well, you simply saw that, okay, based on the recipe above, that there were two buns equivalent to every one burger that were up there, right? So you saw that there was a relationship, right? So for every burger, we have two buns that are there, and we can essentially show that, hey, there is a relationship with that, right? For every 1 divided by 2. And we can see, well, what happens to that is that your units end up canceling as a result. So you got 13 divided by 2, made 6.5 burgers. So you did that dimensional analysis in your head, right? So, and this is the same idea as what stoichiometry is about. Can you essentially cancel something as simple out as food or burgers or whatever it is that you're trying to see? So let's try to look at this slightly different, but with the same example. So instead of looking at it just like pictures, what if we make our recipe look like a chemical reaction where I all of a sudden replace all the pictures and goofy little things, where I have 2 buns with 1 piece of cheese with 1 patty is equal to a burger? You can show that the exact same way, and we can illustrate that our units are going to cancel out. Now, the most important part about this is this middle component here in the middle, which showed that there was a relationship found within our chemical equation, right? 2 buns were equivalent to 1 burger, meaning that essentially with any chemical equation, you can use the coefficients to relate different terms. So for every 2 buns, you make 1 burger. For every 2 buns, you need 1 piece of cheese, right? For every 2 buns, you need 1 patty. There are all these different little relationships that can be found with them. Now, even though we said that, 1 burger is equivalent to 2 buns, you could say all kinds of different relationships that are of the same, essentially the same depth between them, right? So 1 to 2. I could also say 1 dozen burgers equivalent to 2 dozen buns, right? It's the same 1 to 2 relationship. Same thing if I want to use something that's a little bit more common when it comes to looking at chemistry, right? 1 mole of burgers, which would be a ton of patties or a ton of burgers, is equivalent to 2 moles of buns. There's the same 1 to 2 relationship. So we can use this in terms of balanced chemical equations to show a relationship. Let's take a look at an example using this. The whole idea of stoichiometry is you're trying to put chemical equations to work, right? Can you put a balanced chemical equation and show what the mole-to-mole relationship is? So this is going to use our chemical equations. We can use molar mass, molarity, ideal gas law. All these other concepts can come into play because the goal is always the mole. If you can get the moles, you can then use the balanced chemical equation to predict, to be able to figure out how much are you going to make, how much did you need to make all these different recipes. This is something very important. So let's say if I take this unbalanced chemical equation, can I put this to work? Well, first things first is when we want to balance this, first tip that I always give is even out the odds, meaning that if you notice on the right-hand side, we have 3 hydrogens, on the left, you have 2, so they're not even. So if I were to even it out, right, where now I have 6 hydrogens on the right and 6 hydrogens on the left, now our problem, if you notice, the nitrogen's balanced, everything is balanced. So what can we do from this? Well, we can show different relationships here between all these coefficients that are in front of all these numbers, whether it's one with NH3 or H2, or even the one here for nitrogen, which is equivalent to a 1. We can define these, which is what makes chemical equations very powerful. So for example, if I want to say, start with nitrogen, I could say that 1 mole of nitrogen is equivalent to 2 moles of NH3. I could also say that 1 mole of nitrogen is equivalent or can be converted to 3 moles of hydrogen, right? So those are equivalent as well. And just to kind of make it a little easier, right, we can show the color coding here that we had earlier just to be able to follow so we can see what's equivalent. Now, is that everything that can be equivalent? Well, we can also do the same thing when it came to with hydrogen as well. 3 moles of hydrogen is equivalent to 2 moles of NH3. There are multiple relationships that are hidden within the chemical equation. And the thing with all these is because they are conversion factors, you can flip them and use them to convert from one unit to another. So let's say you start with some with grams. You can use the molar mass to convert that to moles. And then you can use the chemical equation to go one step farther It's powerful knowing how to do stoichiometry. It's one of the most important things that we do in chemistry is to be able to predict. For our last example, let's say if we start with the exact same type of problem we had earlier, which was when we did our hamburger example, we had so many number of buns available. What if we do it with moles in a chemical equation? Well, if I have 17 moles of ammonium, right, so which is our product here at the very end, and I ask you how many moles of nitrogen and hydrogen did you start with in this problem? How could we do it? Well, the first thing is when we have a relationship here, we can define all of the different mole fractions. Now, do you have to write them every single one of them down? The short answer is no. You have to pick which ones you need to use. So in this problem, what we are starting with is that we know that we have 17 moles of NH3. And the first thing is that asks you to do is to go to nitrogen. Okay. So what is our relationship between ammonia and nitrogen? And one thing that we can see is that, well, for every two moles of ammonia, right? So if I kind of write that down here, 2 moles of NH3, I am going to need 1 mole of nitrogen in order to make ammonia, right? So there's a 2-to-1 relationship, which is coming from those chemical coefficients that we showed earlier. We're using this relationship over here. Now, when we do that, right? So 17 divided by 2, what are you going to have? Well, that we're going to have 8.5 moles of nitrogen is what our answer is going to be. We can write that down. So 8.5 moles of N2, right? So it gives us an idea of exactly how many moles that we're going to have for our first problem. Now, what about for hydrogen? Let's do the same thing. So let's move this down. And we're once again going to be starting with 17 moles of NH3. And we're going to use the chemical equation for what our relationship between ammonia and hydrogen are. Well, if you remember, for every 2 moles of NH3, there is going to be 3 moles of hydrogen. All right. And that's given us another relationship that's here. What we can do is we do 17 times 3 divided by 2. And that's going to tell you that, hey, you started with 25.5 moles of H2. So you can convert this to different units. Now, if you need to figure out the mass, or let's say how many liters of gas there are, you could do even follow-up steps, which I do in my other videos. So this is the idea. So that's the final concept of stoichiometry, is can you read a chemical recipe? Because all it does is takes a balanced chemical equation and relates that to moles. It follows the dimensional analysis idea as a unit conversion. So can you convert? Can you balance? And if you need that help, look at my other videos to help you with that. Go look through the homepage, that everything's labeled by playlist to help you further, okay? Thank you so much for listening. I hope you have a wonderful day. And this was your first time here. Please hit that like and subscribe button. And if you are confused, comment below and I can help guide you to the right place and help you with the resources you need. Okay. Thank you and bye-bye.